I would prefer to begin this discussion a bit abruptly. If you had to say a few words of consolation to a Ukrainian woman who fled the country or whose husband died in the war, what would you say to her?
Well, if someone had lost their husband or their son or their daughter or wife in this conflict, all I would say is what is always said in these situations, particularly when a country is fighting for its freedom. I would say, let's pray they didn't die in vain. I mean, what would be absolutely horrible would be to think that they died and Ukraine was defeated. So what you say to console is the hope that because of these sacrifices, Ukraine one day will live in freedom, and that their children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren will live in a free country. But let's be very honest, I'm not sure that this is very consoling at all. It's what has been said to widows of soldiers for thousands of years. And sometimes it consoles them and sometimes it doesn't.
In your opinion, how could we explain the fact that majority of Russian population support Putin and the war?
I think the real reason is that Russia is not a free society. If you do the thought experiment, what would Russian attitudes towards the war be if there was a free opposition, free media, and free public debate in Russia? I think you would have a lot of Russians saying, are you crazy invading a neighboring country that presents no threat to you? Spending 300,000 people to the front line to die in the mud of Ukraine for what? You would have a vigorous public debate. But if you have a country where for 20 years an authoritarian has pummeled a free press, arrested and deported and killed, let's also be clear, killed dissenters. Nemtsov, the opposition politician, was killed within sight of the Kremlin towers. If you have a society that's been subjected to that amount of terror intimidation, it's actually not surprising that Russians either keep their mouths shut or believe this authoritarian leader. But what this tells you is that if you have in Europe, and Russia is in Europe, an authoritarian state dominated by police terror intimidation, such a state is then a danger to the security of the entirety of Europe, precisely because of the character of the regime. And that's why it seems to me, of course there will be people in Russia who will believe this is 1941 again, the whole world is attacking us, we must fight, Mother Russia must rise and defend itself. But the critical factor is the institutional, the destruction of free press, free media, and a pluralist opposition that would have focused opposition to the war and possibly led the country to say, no, we are not going to invade a peaceful country next door.
How do you see the political regime in Russia, more specific, it's like a fascism, it's another kind of regime.
I don't think it's fascist, which doesn't mean to say I don't think it's violent, aggressive, and dangerous, and profoundly destructive to human freedom. I take all that. But I think it's not like Hitler's Germany or Mussolini's Italy. There's something different here. It's a terrible new hybrid created in the post-89 transition that Romania went through, a transition which sought to bring integration into the capitalist market economy with democratic institutions. And this transition failed and produced a monster. And the monster is an economy which is dependent on a single commodity, basically oil and gas. And that commodity then produces huge revenue streams to the central authority, allowing it to consolidate power. It's integrated into the capitalist economy so it can sell this product and make huge profit. The system then, this centralization of power allowed the authoritarian dictator, Mr. Putin, to seize control of the democratic system and strip it out of everything that makes a democracy, namely pluralism, separation of powers, free media. And so it's a monstrous new regime created essentially in a failed transition after 1989. And it's a warning to other parts of the world. And let's also be clear that this transition after 1989 created kleptocratic regimes in Romania, in Bulgaria, Serbia. It's created this monstrous regime in Hungary. And all of these are something new in the world. That is an attempt to combine openness to the capitalist economy with democracy, but the linkage between the two, between capitalism and democracy, has gone wrong in each of these societies, but in a specific way, specific to each of those societies. And Russia is the worst example of it.
So do you think there is still hope for Russia? Could Russia at some point resume a direction toward democracy?
We know historically that the one time when Russia turned briefly in a democratic direction was after defeat. And that was in 1905, after the defeat, when Japan defeated the Russian Empire and forced the Tsarist regime to embark hesitatingly towards constitutional monarchy. Second time in which Russia had an opportunity to embark on a democratic path was after defeat in 1989-1991 with the collapse of the Soviet Union. So defeat in both cases was an opportunity for a democratic turn, and in both cases, instead of consolidating democracy, Russia has consolidated an authoritarian return. We're witnessing the disintegration of the last land empire in Europe. I mean, we need to situate this in terms of the collapse of the British Empire, the Dutch Empire, the French Empire. And in all of those cases, this produced enormous internal struggle to have a society accept that it was no longer an imperial power. And Russia is going through the same torment. And I think, to answer your question, the only possible way in which Russia returns to a democratic path that it went on briefly twice will be another defeat, in this case, military defeat in Ukraine. But let's also be very clear, military defeat in Ukraine could lead to a still more authoritarian regime, or it could lead to civil war. So I look at the future in a rather pessimistic way. I pray that Russia can return to a democratic path, but I think it has to, it can only do so after a cataclysm, after a defeat which teaches it that it has reached the end of the possibilities of authoritarian control. But it hasn't got there yet, and it still hopes it can win in Ukraine. And until it understands that it can't win in Ukraine, this madness will go on.
Changing a little bit the perspective, I want to ask you if there's a possibility of consolation for those who feel frustrated.
Consolation, one of the meanings of consolation is to accept a disagreeable reality, to understand that something's happened and not to fight it further and to acknowledge that it's occurred, whether it's a defeat, whether it's death, whether it's a loss, whether it's a failure. And I think the question of whether Russia could be consoled for a defeat in Ukraine is a question of whether it can accept the reality, the historical reality of defeat. As you know, I'm a Canadian citizen, so I'm close to the British experience. The British have had a terribly difficult time accepting that they once were one of the most powerful countries in the world, and now they're not. Many countries go through this experience. France has had to go through it too. It used to think it was civilisation universelle, and it's discovered it's one country among 27 on the northern frontier, the northern edge of Europe. Countries have to awake from their memories of greatness and accept their diminished condition in the world. And when they get that right, they go out and create a vibrant, innovative, pluralist, happy democracy, which accepts their middling place in the world. And this will be the challenge for Russia. It could console itself for defeat if it accepts defeat and understands that there is no return to empire. But accepting there is no return to empire is extremely difficult for every country. France, Britain, the Netherlands. Well, the Netherlands has done it pretty well. So it's possible, but this would require a revolution in Russian consciousness, which has seen itself as an empire for five centuries, that will take a very long time to work through, and I think will take most of the 21st century.
You make a distinction between consolation and comfort.
Well, comfort, we engage in comfort all the time in English. In the English language, there's a phrase called comfort food. A nice hot soup when you're feeling a little low or you're feeling a little lonesome. My wife, for example, eats poppy seed pasta, which is a Hungarian dish she loves, and that's comfort food for her. Comfort food for me is bacon and eggs. But the point being that comfort is simply something that makes us feel better, feel less alone, less depressed. And when we try to comfort someone else, all that it means is sitting with them and listening to them and perhaps putting our arms over their on their shoulders and giving them a hug. But if we console them, we're doing something very different. We're trying to give them some meaning for their experience of loss or failure or grief. That allows them to bear it and gives them hope or sufficient hope to go on. And that's much more demanding than comfort. It's propositional. We have to provide meanings. And that's why consolation is so very difficult, because there's some experiences for which consolation is just impossible. We can comfort someone for the loss of their mother or their father, but we can't console them because the loss is irreparable. It can't be made good. And many of the times when we do try to console somebody for the loss of their loved ones, the words sound hollow because we know and they know that the promise of consolation can't be delivered. consolation is at the limit of human solidarity and at the limit of language. And that's why I find it such a fascinating subject, and why I've written about 18 great examples of people trying to console themselves or console others historically, and how they did it.
You say in your book, yet when suffering become understood as an illness with a cure, something is lost. What is lost when you treat suffering as a disease, as an infirmity?
We have medicalized a great deal of suffering in the 20th century. Freud began, I think, the process of trying to convert hysterical misery into common unhappiness by a thing called the talking cure. You sit on the couch and you talk it through. And I, having had therapy myself, would not want to dismiss it. But the idea that sadness, suffering, is an illness, I think, is condescending to suffering, condescending to our experience. When you experience grief over the death of a loved one, you're not ill, you're not sick. You're just doing something that's very, very human, which is to register in your sense of loss the force of the love that you felt for someone. There's no illness here, and there's no cure for that. It's just part of being human. And so I think we need to respect grief, and we need to respect suffering. We need to seek to overcome it, obviously, but we need to respect it for what it is. And there isn't a pill for this. You know, you can't take a pill for grief. I don't want to advertise the fact. I recently lost my brother. My brother died just before Christmas, about a month ago. And I feel sorrow at his loss. I'm not sick. I'm not ill. I'm just sad. And it seems to me perfectly normal and necessary part of human life to go through these experiences and try and draw meaning from them. And then, if possible, to console yourself for their loss. In my case, I console myself with the thought that my brother had been ill for a very long time, and his sufferings are now ended. And so in that sense, it's consoling for me to think that my brother is no longer suffering, but I miss him. I wish he was here, but he's not.
You discuss in this book, from the position of an unbeliever, the way consolation appears in the writings of Old Testament, and say, for example, that Job, in the book of Job, find consolation when God show him his greatness. It is precisely this incomprehensibility of God that console Job and restore his life.
My book begins with the story of Job because it's one of the most brutal stories in the Bible and in our tradition. I mean, here is a just man, a man who loves his God and lives according to God's law, who's punished by God senselessly. He loses everything. His children die. He's afflicted with the plague and with sores. And people come to him and try to console him, false comforters, and say, you've got to accept God's sentence, God's justice. And the great thing about Job to me is that he rebels. He shakes his fist at the sky and says, God, why are you doing this to me? And astoundingly in the story, God answers. And God's answer is consoling only if you're a believer. I'm not. What God says is, Job, I am God. I'm the creator of the sun, the stars, and the firmament, and the entirety of reality. And you're asking me some silly question about why you suffer. It's too complicated for you to understand. You're just going to have to accept that this is the order of the world that I created, and it's And Job, I think, is consoled by the fact that God actually chooses to answer him. The answer, the content of the answer is pretty, not very consoling, but Job gets an answer. And I think that what is consoling then about the Job story to Job is that he got an answer. And what is consoling to us, I think, is something very different, which is that Job is the prototypical human being in relation to suffering. Job tells us, the Job story tells us, that we never simply suffer and endure it quietly. We are always asking, why is this happening? Why am I getting cancer? Why did my brother die, although he's 3 years younger than me? Why did my mother die? Why did I fail at something I wanted to do so much? We're always asking why about the question of suffering. And it's in when we ask the question why, we begin the search for consolation. That is to find a meaning that will allow us to bear a reversal, a grief, a loss, and find a way to go on in the future. And Job, by asking God, why am I suffering, receives an answer which is difficult to understand, but it gives him the feeling that he has been heard by God and can go on. And in that sense, the Job story is a story of consolation. And that's why I began the book with it, because it's so fascinating metaphor for the whole of our human experience of consolation.
Our ideology, a form of consolation.
I devote a chapter to Marx, particularly the young Marx, and people are a little surprised what's Marx doing in a book about consolation, because Marx very explicitly rejected religion precisely because he regarded it as a false attempt to console ordinary human beings for sufferings that they should fight to overcome by making revolution. To your question about ideology, Marxism became, and Romanians know this only too well, the reigning ideology of many societies for most of the 20th century. And while those who were convinced Marxists would never admit it, it was very consoling because it enabled you to say, we Marxists are in possession of a theory of history which confidently promises that the class antagonisms will be eventually overcome. The enemies of a perfect society will either see their error or their ways or be eliminated, and we will eventually arrive at the land that Marx promised us, which was a world in which we live in plenty, there is equality, and we criticize in the morning and we milk cows in the evening and we criticize after dinner and we have a happy life together. And this was, in my view, a consoling fantasy about history that enabled people to commit a great number of crimes because they believed that history would justify the cruelties that they inflicted in order to secure this radiant tomorrow. Romanians have been through this story and seen how cruel this ideology was. And I guess what I want to say in this book is, let's try and find hope without ideology. Let's try and find hope without false stories of historical progress that are bound to end up justifying forms of cruelty and abuse to other human beings.